So the way I think of this is, if like a dominant team in the 2020s means a team that every year is a strong candidate to make the playoffs, like okay. A lot of people have, like I think of Oklahoma in that. I think of certainly Alabama, Clemson, Ohio State. I think Georgia probably as well. Those are kind of like the five dominant teams right now. Some combination of them is always in everyone's preseason playoffs.
Sure. We got some options here then, if we're going to limit it kind of that five.
Right. So like, but I don't know, like I didn't necessarily go to like Florida and say they're going to be, you know, because Florida, I think is like, I sort of cut off a lot of those teams right on the cusp of that as well. So sure. Let me give you a couple that come to mind. So there's three that come to mind, because I guess there's a, you know, there's those that elite group, and then there's the group that's contending to be in that elite group already, and then there's sort of the just outside. And three teams that come to mind as just outside that could have the ceiling of being dominant. One is Oregon, and Oregon, you could even make a case Oregon is already like on the cusp, but I do think Oregon, it wouldn't shock me if Oregon was just, you pencil them in as the Pac-12 champion every year in within a few seasons, because like the way I certainly look at it is who's recruiting at a really high level, who's going to continue to recruit at a really high level and has sort of the energy to keep that pace. I think that the Mario Cristobal does, and I think they have the right mindset. I think they have a friendly environment to be continuously successful there in the Pac-12. And so I think Oregon could be that team. I also mentioned Tennessee. They're not there yet. They're not going to be there this year, but I think there's a lot of really strong indicators that Tennessee is building it the right way. I think there's a lot of really strong indicators that Jeremy Pruitt is no faker as a coach. And I think Tennessee, I mean, that still is a program with tremendous pedigree. It's, you know, it will not be strange if we see Tennessee dominating college football again. Like, that's not going to be hard to sort of fathom. And then the last one I have here, and there's some others that are sort of, I would throw in there to discuss, but the other one that I have that sort of fits this to a T to me is North Carolina. I mean, Mac Brown, you know, when check out my social distance interview with Stanford Steve, if you haven't, he was awesome. North Carolina was recruiting him back in like 95 out of Connecticut. That was where he chose, or he, that was his like runner up school to Stanford. And he said like his visit there in 95, like was, when he saw that team, the talent on that team was like, it was a Mac Brown team, was some of the most incredible talent he'd ever seen and has ever seen since. And I just think about that, and it's like, Mac Brown's already done this once there. And now he's gone to Texas. He's won a national championship there. He's learned from where his missteps were there. He's back. They're recruiting at a really high level. The state of North Carolina is just bubbling with talent. They have a quarterback. And then they're in a very friendly conference in terms of like how to, you know, a conference that there's some upward mobility to climb to the top of the ledge. I just think North Carolina, it's really easy to see this being a team that, in the same way Clemson sort of came out of nowhere as a non-traditional power, and I could very easily see North Carolina be kind of juggernautish if things track. I mean, this is going to be a critical year. We'll see what happens this year. If they take the next big step forward, that'll be telling. Or if it's just, you know, whatever, if they go 6-6 or 7-5, then maybe we pump the brakes. But they're certainly seem to be heading in the right direction.
I don't hate those picks. I don't love them quite as much as you do. I mean, I'll be honest. I'm kind of our low man by a lot on Oregon, just looking at the internal voting with 24/7.
But it's not just next year, right?
Right.
We're talking about 2020s.
Long term, I like it.
Yeah, yeah.
I do have a couple. I have a related question for both Oregon and for UNC. Who is UNC's head coach in 2025 and who's Oregon's head coach in 2025?
So, I mean, I think Mario Cristobal, it's not hard for me to, like, there's, like, where would Mario Cristobal go?
Bama.
All right. Okay. So, but there's another, like, if the teams that I just mentioned hit as dominant teams in the 2020s,
right? Okay.
Let's just say the early 2020s. Okay. Who's the more likely head coach at Tennessee, Mario Cristobal or Jeremy Pruitt? I'm sorry, at Alabama.
That's a good point. Yeah.
So, like, one of these, maybe they'll cancel each other out because one of these guys will end up in Alabama. But I think there are other candidates for Alabama that make sense, you know, even if Mario Cristobal hits.
And I mean, not to just totally derail the conversation into the who replaces Nick Saban combo, because I'm sure we'll do a longer feature on that at some point. And I don't think he's anywhere close to retiring. But like, Bama screwed themselves up for like about a decade or you know, 12-year period, just trying to basically like recapture that Bear Bryant magic by having, like, mandating that they would hire somebody who was on Bear Bryant's staff, right? Kind of like USC did for a long time with having to have somebody who was related to Pete Carroll, even though it doesn't really, like, that's not how successful teams, you know, seem to work. But I don't hate those picks. I think if Cristobal, if his new offensive coordinator there, Joe Moorhead, if Cristobal is hands off, then I think Oregon's going to be better than I think they're going to be. I have some concerns about Oregon because last year they still didn't have a top 20 level offense, and they had Justin Herbert, and they just lost four offensive linemen and a good number of other stuff. With UNC, see,
but you're getting caught in a little bit of like the, like, this season, like, sure, what, like, what's, how are things going to work this season? Like, I'm thinking about just like the bones of the program. Like, I'm thinking, like, if they're the dominant team of the 2020s, Joe Moorhead's only going to be there like 3 years anyways. Like, or if, right, they're, you know, like, so I'm thinking of like head coach, access to talent, willingness to recruit, ability to recruit, infrastructure in, yeah, place, fan base willing to engage, whatever. Like, all these just sort of more macro, like, elements, as opposed to sort of these things that could and probably will change from a year-to-year basis.
So your choices are more daring than mine are. And I like them better. I'm going to go with two that I think are not totally off the board, but maybe we shouldn't have skipped over them. Texas and USC.
Okay.
My thought here is that either they're gonna get good really soon, or they're gonna have the money and spend the money to go out and hire coaches who can do it. Like, to me, this is kind of a make it or break it year for Tom Herman. He goes another year without playing in that Big 12 title game. And like, if they flop this year with Ellinger and with all those DBs they recruited, I don't know if we're talking about Tom Herman there in 2021. You know, and I don't know what all this COVID stuff's gonna do as far as hiring and firing hot seat season, but I mean, that's a program that has the resources to do it. They have a national championship, at least in the BCS era. You know, it's within the last 15 years. They've played for another one in whatever year that was. They played, was that 2011 they played Bama, or 2010, 2009 maybe, whatever it was. They could do it, and I think USC could also do it. Maybe those are just too blue bloody. I think your answers were more creative there. I like those.
So my Texas, all right, so like if – as you project Texas as a dominant team of the 2020s, and you're envisioning Texas as a dominant team of the 2020s, are you envisioning Texas as a dominant team of the 2020s with Tom Herman as their head coach?
No,
are you saying that it could happen with them, but it also could happen without him?
I like the pick because it doesn't have to happen with him. I think their bones are good enough. Their access to talent are good enough. I mean, who knows? Maybe Lincoln Riley will go to the Cowboys at some point, right? And he'll stop killing the Longhorns. I feel like Chris Del Conte is a good AD and will evaluate that situation correctly. And if Herman's not the guy, then they'll go out and get somebody.
Texas is interesting because, one, it feel like I still think the Texas under Tom Herman is capable of having a good season and making the playoffs. Washington had a good season and made the playoffs. Michigan State had a good season and made the playoffs. And Washington has continued to be a consistent, successful team. But it feels like to me, if Texas under Tom Herman was going to be a perennial playoff team in the same way Oklahoma is, Alabama or Clemson, it feels like we would know that by now. Not necessarily, they wouldn't even have to have been in the playoffs by now, but it feels like we would, in heading into year four, we would have a pretty good sense of that. And we just don't. Like, they went 7-6, 10-4, 8-5. There's been inconsistencies, you know, throughout. And they still recruit well. I don't know. Maybe this is the year. Like he basically took his Houston staff with him. He's made a couple of changes since, but you know, the big shakeup this year at offensive and defensive coordinator. Maybe that's what they're missing. But it feels like perennially dominant Texas is either just isn't with Tom Herman. Doesn't mean they're not perennially good. Doesn't mean that they're not perennially a Big 12 contender, but it feels like perennially dominant on a national scale. We would know that by now.
So yeah, I mostly agree with you there, right? I was on the fade Texas train last year. I bet them under. I was wagering against them in early games. I thought that the way their roster set up, what they lost off the 2018 team was an important amount of stuff that they lost, right? Like, it was going to hurt them. And that didn't really fit a lot of the media narrative out there, because they're like, oh, it's Tom Herman's, you know, second full year on the job, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, yeah, but like, the players on your roster, they matter. And they were going to be very young on defense last year. And with that, they had a lot of guys last year who got hurt on defense. And so a lot of my Texas friends, who I believe are pretty smart folks, were like, hey, man, like, they've lost so much on defense now with these injuries, they're kind of crippled. And I was like, okay, got it. But then Herman goes out and changes up almost his entire staff. I'm like, damn. Like, if the narrative is, hey, we were just young and we were super young due to injuries, especially on defense, and the numbers show that. I mean, they were 10th in offensive SP plus, 68th in defensive SP plus. Like, yeah, they were terrible on defense and pretty damn good on offense. If the numbers show that, and you really believe your issue was like your young guys getting hurt in the secondary, then why are you firing your coaches? Maybe it shows that maybe this is a little more of a panic move than Texas fans want to admit. So yeah, I'm not fully sold that Tom Herman's going to be the guy leading them to the playoff, but I am kind of on board with Texas as a bit of a bounce back this year.
Yeah, and I think Texas, like, this is a huge year. This is they could make the playoffs this year. Like, they're an absolute dark horse playoff contender. So. But if this is another 8-5 year, if this is a 9-4 year, even, then it's sort of like, all right, what have we really achieved? This is University of Texas.